isn't working. TVI goes to Tees Street, the street where every householder is out of work. People like Vince Baker, selling his fishing rod to buy cigarettes. People like June Wilde, with 10 children, seeking help over a huge electricity bill. People like Mick Searson, aged 42, giving up hope of working again. Tees Street, Birkenhead, on Merseyside, a region classified as one of the most depressed in Europe. But Tees Street has a special claim to fame. No adult over 20 has a regular job, apart from Danny Doyle, who's 35 and blind. He works in the Unemployment Benefits Office, an ironic twist of fate.
Yeah, I suppose there is with so many people in this particular area being unemployed. And me having a job, really, you might say, if they had a job, there'd be no need for me to have one.
6 years ago, Danny's father was made redundant from the shipyards. The Doyle family live at number 5 Tees Street. Danny's three brothers are part of the street pattern of unemployment.
They've been looking for jobs for so long that you do in the end, you give up, you know. It just gets so depressing. Anybody gets a joke, mentions a job, it's a joke, you know, nobody gets a job. So the kids seeing this, obviously they're not growing up with any worth ethic to follow or anything, you know. To them it's normal to be out of work, to be just around the house, and to be going down to sign on each week, so, you know, there's no future for them at all.
Refuse collection day in Tees Street, and a reminder for two of Danny Doyle's brothers of the last time they had a weekly pay packet. 2 years ago, Stephen and Noel were bin men when the local council ran the service.
Well, they sold off to their private enterprise firm called Waste Management. Took over in June 1883.
Did a lot of jobs go then?
Oh, yeah, a couple of hundred.
So what happened to you after that?
Well, we had a few bob from the superannuation. So we decided, instead of blowing it, and we couldn't get a job anyway, try and make a start on a market stall.
The brothers were helped in their market stall business by a grant of £40 a week each for a year under a government scheme.
Birkenhead was all right at first. Well, we thought it was all right, because it was our first market, obviously, but after a while, you get to hear of other markets and that, and you go to them, and after you finally get on, you know what's better.
They were selling glass, china, fancy goods. But it took them most of their government-assisted year to get the hang of the business. 9 months ago, that year came to an end, and their money ran out.
How do you see the future? Because you ought to have quite long working lives ahead of you at your age. When you look ahead, what do you see?
At least a few more years of signing on.
I think my next job would be a lollipop man. At 65.
In Birkenhead, 20 years ago, there were over 14,000 jobs in the shipyards. Now there are 1,300. In those days, male unemployment of 45% in the area was unthinkable. Now it's fact. Number 3, Tees Street. 39-year-old Vince Baker is short of money for cigarettes. He's taking his fishing rod, which cost him £3, to the shop where he bought it to sell it back. He was a building labourer. He's married with two children. He's been unemployed for most of the last 10 years.
Well, I can't see how I can see any prospects. All I see around me is places shutting down.
People sometimes say that people who are out of work don't try hard enough to find work. What would you say to that?
They get to a stage where they don't try hard enough, because they just get chased off with it.
How do you see your future then?
Me? I can see myself being on the dole for the rest of my life.
To walk down T Street is to walk through a small society where conventional hopes and ambitions have largely been abandoned. On this side, a man of 54, a former dock diver and building charge hand, who's been unemployed for 7 years. He's got 5 children. On this side, a former rigger in a ship repair yard who's bringing up 4 children on his own since his wife left him recently. He's been unemployed for 8 years. And on it goes into the next generation. On this side, a father jobless for 8 years with 3 children of working age, none of whom have found work since leaving school. Growing up in T Street nowadays means coming to terms with aimlessness.
Particularly those with children in their charge must also come to terms with the rules, regulations, and pressures of living on welfare. One man who tries to help is Nick Warren. He's a solicitor employed by a Birkenhead charity to give free advice on social security, unemployment benefit, housing, on any one of 100 problems that may suddenly be serious. This call is to number 15 T Street, to June Wild, a divorcee with 4 of her 10 children at home, unemployed for 10 years.
Mrs. Wild?
Yes.
My name's Nick Warren. I understand you're in a bit of trouble with the letting.
Yes.
Is this convenient?
Yes, yes.
The electricity bill June Wild has received is startling.
What's the electricity bill? £1,000.
Let's see. 200 quid for this quarter?
Yeah.
And 900...
That was for the July quarter. That was the main one that will...
All of it?
Yeah. 900 for one quarter bill.
What would your ordinary electricity bill be?
£74. That was the highest one, £106.
And how do you normally pay for it?
I save £10 a week with the Social Security voluntary.
Do they know you're on supplementary?
Yeah.
Well, how long have you
had... They said if I didn't pay the £54 within 7 days, they were going to cut me off.
This was Nick Warren's first encounter a few weeks ago with the mystery of June Wild's extraordinary bill. He's still trying to resolve it.
I don't know what happens when the next £54 due.
One of June Wild's sons, 18-year-old Robbie, has been working in a scrap metal yard for 2 months. It's taken him 2 years to get a job.
I tried and tried and tried for ages, and eventually it got me one, but I've seen people there trying for 2 years and they still haven't got one.
Worn-out hulks are broken up for scrap in an area where great ships were once proudly built. If some of Robbie's friends now feel themselves to be on the scrap heap, it's not for want of trying to do better.
I've known quite a few of my mates to go down to the job centre every single day, and all they've got is interviews. They've got to be either 18 or the other jobs, you've got to be brainy. You know what I mean? And some of them, you know, they're not daft. Some of them have got brains, but they just can't get the jobs.
Robbie Wild and 2 other T Street teenagers are working, together with Danny Doyle, the blind man. But out of 32 households, no householder has a job. And in nearly every house, there is at least one man or woman of working age without work. A total of 38 unemployed. From number 28 T Street, Mike Jenkins, aged 34, an electrician, married, with 4 children, has been offered a chance of reducing that total by 1. But he's got a long way to go. Unemployed for 2 years, he's on his way to be interviewed for a job at the Atomic Energy Research Establishment at Harwell in Oxfordshire.
How important is this job to you, Mike, if you get it?
Well, very important, really, to get away from this area where there's no work for the children in later years when they grow up.
What do you think your chances are?
Well, as good as the next, I would think.
No such hope is likely for the householder at number 10, 42-year-old Mick Searson.
What do you see your chances now in terms of the rest of your working life?
Very poor. Very poor.
I can't see any prospects.
Nick Searson, married with three children, unemployed for more than 10 years, last worked as a labourer building the M53.
I was on there about 2.5 years, 3 years, something like that.
That must have been good money.
Yes, at the time it was, yes. About £70 a week then.
When you were doing that job, which is the last time that you did work, did you feel then that there would be another job coming when that ended?
Yes, I did. I really thought there was more work coming up in the country.
And you never at that stage could have foreseen a situation where for more than 10 years you wouldn't work?
No, I didn't.
So what happened when that job finished?
Well, nothing. Did nothing. Just on the dole, and that was it.
Harwell, Oxfordshire, 160 miles away.
Good morning, I'm Mr. Jenkins. I've been into 10:45.
2 years of unemployment haven't dulled the determination of Mike Jenkins. David Hornby, aged 31, climbs onto the roof of his own house at number 16 T Street. Last year, after 6 years without work, he started his own business as a TV aerial fitter with the help of a government scheme. But he had to wait 9 months for a telephone.
Well, I went into aerial fitting, which to advertise, obviously you need a telephone. And because I couldn't advertise, I wasn't getting the business. The business I was getting was mostly due to word of mouth, and it was in the immediate area, you know.
So what happened then? At 9 months, they said they could give you a phone, but by that stage, what, you decided you didn't want it?
Well, I had 3 months left on the enterprise allowance scheme. So, I mean, it wasn't worth getting a phone installed at that time, because the business was sinking so much that there was no way that a phone was going to cure that, you know.
So at the end of the year then, the allowance ceased and so did the business?
That's it, yeah.
Former builder's labourer Vince Baker, from number 3, tried minicabbing last year, but had an accident and lost his licence. That apart, he spent 10 years looking for a job.
I see jobs attractive, but I'm not qualified to do it. I mean, there is good jobs in the labour exchange for fully qualified people.
But for unskilled people like yourself?
Unskilled people, there's nothing. I mean, I've seen jobs for £30-40 a week. My children probably went on that.
There are 10,000 unemployed in Birkenhead, chasing 600 jobs in the job centre. As the manager explains, very few of them are for unskilled workers like Vince.
A handful. Very, very few. There's such a demand for the labouring jobs that as soon as we get them, they're filled. They just never stay on the board for more than a few minutes.
If somebody is prepared to move, and the question of mobility of labour is often raised as an answer to unemployment, if someone is prepared to move, how difficult is that?
It's difficult because of housing. That's the problem. For a person with housing here, either rented housing or home-owned housing, it's very difficult if you're going to an area where there are jobs, if the housing is so much more expensive, and often rented housing isn't available.
That, too, was a problem that Vince Baker has had to face.
I was sent after one job. I was out in Wales, a handyman. I had to leave my wife, my children, and my home, and go and live out in Wales. That's the only one they've offered me.
I mean, moving is not a real possibility for you then, is it?
Well, I don't see how I can really move. All my family, my friends are around this area.
So it's no good saying to somebody with a wife and children that there is a job down south, because there won't be accommodation to go with it?
Not usually. Some do. We do have many instances of people going, but it's a problem, and we can't disguise the problem.
So the phrase, on your bike, without asking you to make a political comment, has not been particularly helpful?
No.
Because you can't carry your family with you on the bike?
No.
For the unemployed in T Street, as in so many streets like this on Merseyside and across the north, hope is hard to keep alive. Even with training for skills, which very few of them have, there are still too few jobs in the area and too many people wanting them. They could pull up their roots and move south where there are jobs, but they know, and the job centre knows, that even if work is available down there, accommodation usually isn't. They are trapped here in a lifestyle from which few, as things are likely to escape.
Afternoon darts in T Street. Youth training schemes can offer temporary escape, but all too often, in the experience of the street, no more than that. All three darts players have been on such schemes, but two of them have failed to find work since.
Just there, going and all the mates' houses and sisters' houses and there, just playing darts and watching the telly and all things like that. That's why I get up about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, so there's not a lot of the day left.
Is there any point in doing any reading or studying that might help you?
But what for? What's the point in doing studying and reading all these books on how to be a joiner or something like that? When you go down a job centre, for the kick-off, you've got to have O-levels. And if you haven't got O-levels, goodbye. Don't want to know you.
For those who feel they're going nowhere, the Red Bus offers some assistance in coping with where they are. It's part of a local service run by the unemployed for the unemployed with funds from Merseyside Council. It offers advice on the often complex rules that govern the claiming of welfare benefits.
We were saying there that you'd wait 3 to 4 weeks for your claim to come through, but at the moment they've got a backlog of 700 claims, so we're saying up to about 7 weeks for them to come through.
There are warnings on the bus that officialdom is watching out for fiddles and false claims. Yet this year, the service reckons that £300,000 worth of legitimate benefit has not been claimed in the area. And that matches the experience of solicitor Nick Warren, who's one of those who helps the unemployed to get what they're entitled to.
Easily the majority of my customers are claiming less than they're entitled to. There's no question of that. As far as the generality is concerned, I think it's important to remember that claimants are exactly like you and me. When I fall ill and go on the sickness and perhaps invalidity benefit, or if I fall unemployed, or when I retire, I will become a claimant. And I won't change my character just because of that. So I suppose in ordinary life you know some people who are extremely greedy, and you know others who aren't, and it's my judgment that the extremely greedy ones are few and far between. But that's my own experience.
There is the argument about whether people really want to work, given that they may well feel that they are better off on the dole than if they were to take a job. Do you find that they have difficulty themselves in working out which is the better course for them?
Well, I think people very often think that they are better off on the dole when they're not, because it can sometimes be a very complex calculation. For example, juggling, oh yes, child benefit will continue and I'll still keep that, but how much will my tax be, and how much will my national insurance be, what will be the effect on my housing benefit of taking a job? The astonishing thing is that there's no government department that you can go to and say to them, look, here's this job I can do at 120 quid a week. What's it going to mean in my hand after I've paid my rent?
An auction room near T Street, where two of its unemployed often go to watch, rarely to buy.
Get that cover off it. You can look on.
This time, Noel Doyle from number 5 watches David Hornby from number 16 bidding for a chair.
40, 60, really
80,
professional.
The bids are a reminder that on T Street, money is hard to come by. by whatever means.
Unemployed people are very like lots of other people. I dare say there are some on the fiddle, just as there are some people in work on the fiddle. All I can say is that going round Birkenhead and visiting people, I don't see many signs of affluence. I don't see many signs of sort of happy-go-lucky people fiddling the taxman and the DHSS simultaneously. I see far more despair at the ideas of ever having a job again, or despair at the prospect of spending years and years and years just waiting for something to turn up.
The only certainty in T Street, as in the world outside, is death. Death called 2 weeks ago at number 10. Mick Searson's wife, an invalid for 4 years following a stroke, looked after by him and his family, died suddenly. On the day of the funeral, the sorrow of one family was the sorrow of a street. Amid the sorrow, there was practical sympathy too. A street collection and contributions from friends helped to pay for a wealth of flowers. But the deeper cost to Mixiason himself, his two sons and his daughter, only they can know, and only they can pay.
Let us pray for Patricia, our sister to our Lord Jesus Christ, who has said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live, and whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. We beg you, Lord, who wept over the dead Lazarus, to wipe away the tears from our eyes. Lord, hear us, and let perpetual light shine upon her. May she rest in peace. Amen.
Afterwards, family and friends from T Street and beyond were to gather in Mick Searson's home at number 10 to pay tribute to the life that is lost and offer strength and comfort to those who have to face the future. But the future, for many in the area, seems, like the present, a betrayal of a proud past. That betrayal has bred not so much resentment as resignation, a feeling among the people of T Street that the country they belong to and its political system can make them no promises they can bring themselves to believe.
Well, I won't exactly run out to vote.
For any party?
For any party.
Do you bother to vote?
No.
Why not?
Because I don't believe in any of them.
Do you vote?
No. I don't bother. It's a waste of time. They all say the same, they'll do this if they get empowered, they'll do this, they'll do that. But when they get empowered, they don't. So it's a waste of time.
I don't vote, I've never have voted.
Why is that?
I was hoping my dad always told me not to vote. And he really did, he told me never to vote.
Well, I think the majority have given up on it.
Well, whoever is in power, it doesn't matter.
Not really, no. To the majority, it doesn't, but it is a minority do still vote and still hope.
One household that still has hope is the family of Mike Jenkins, the electrician from number 28, who still waits for the result of his job interview at Harwell. He believes it went reasonably well and that he's in with a chance. But the price of leaving T Street would be, in the short term, a heavy one for him and his family.
Well, if I have to move for the job, I'll have to do that. But there'll be a long wait. There's the housing list for the accommodation that they provide is 9 months. And you just have to wait. I'll have to stay in a hostel while my wife stayed up here.
And what about moving eventually, lock, stock and barrel, all of you?
Well, it'll be a better life, I think.
With the job, you see. It'll be better than unemployed.
better than what blind Danny Doyle, the one man over 20 with a job, can sense around him.
Well, they don't feel part of society, obviously. I mean, the world's going on around them. People are working, paying taxes. The adverts on the telly are telling you what you need, what you've got to have. Everybody's got to have one of these. How cheap it is, only $4,999, only $250. And, of course, they can't afford anything. So they feel completely isolated from the rest of the society. So everybody is them, as far as they're concerned. So it makes no odds. They get to the point where they just totally give up and they got no interest in politics, they think. Nobody is at all concerned.
And from that feeling comes this poem by David Hornby of number 16 T Street.
Is it right I should be tied in? Held like a bird in some senseless way? And all I've ever had is a long and lonely day. And while you sleep, I fill another page, writing my life in rhyme, hoping tomorrow as a brighter sky, lifting this boredom of mine. But when tomorrow comes, I know it's just another yesterday. And once again, I must face another long and lonely day.